Hello everybody and welcome to this week's ITK Soccer Show. It is the 29th of July 2014, the year of our Lord. And this is episode 2. And before we get started, guys, did you get any feedback on episode 1?
I did, yeah.
And what did they say?
I'm hilarious. Dan needs to calm down.
But
that was just my parents.
Your parents? You should have never revealed that part of it. Just the idea, the mystique that we would have had, listeners, was going to... I was asked, were we drunk? So moving on, were you asked if... were you asked if there was...
No, it went well. I was talking about it pretty good. Like, one of my mates fell asleep from work listening to it twice. So maybe that's not great.
No, that's good. That's what you want from talk radio. Especially if you're tired.
We fixed that problem, though. There's just going to be an alarm every 40 minutes.
Well, actually, speaking of alarms, we had an alarm in last week's show. And that alarm was a beep. So behave yourself. Right? And on that topic, we were talking about this man at the end of last week's show, which kind of caused the beep. So let's start episode 2 talking about Mr. Remy and his deal to Liverpool falling through. I remember last week I was like just so over the moon with this. Yeah. And so this is, it's not unprecedented, but it's terribly shocking. And John, I want to ask you how you felt about it personally. And Dan, I want to ask you if you think Liverpool can in any way get anybody as good for that money.
Yeah. Well, I was devastated when I heard the news yesterday because you're not going to get a striker with that sort of record for that sort of money. Until I heard a stat today of, do you know who the last player who failed the Liverpool medical because of a heart condition was?
No.
Mark Vivian Foe.
God. Yeah. When he passed away in 2002,
yeah, because of a thing on the field. He was supposed to sign for Liverpool from West Ham, but signed for Man City instead because he failed the medical.
Now, wouldn't he have had to do a medical even for the World Cup for France?
Yeah, no. Harry Redknapp, I think he came out and said, easy bottom. And he's had medicals with the French team, and none has picked up. But it is actually a hard thing, because you're the only one who's saying this, John.
No, I've heard a hard thing.
Because, like, Harry Redknapp is adamant, and a lot of the agents are saying it's because Barini wouldn't leave.
I can't imagine they've
got the money quite clearly. They've got 80 million or whatever, so they're not spent a bit. But I'm sure they could have eventually persuaded Barini to leave. Yeah. Like, they wouldn't pull out of the Remy deal. They'd say, look, let's stall it. Let's hold on here. Like,
well, maybe there's something. I've heard heart condition anyway, and that would make sense to me because it seemed to be going on for a weekend. So maybe they just. Mm. And also, I thought it made a bit of sense that maybe the France squad did know about it because they were looking for a goal for about 20 minutes or so against Germany, and they didn't bring him on for the final.
Sure, though.
Yeah.
Exactly. They did not bring him on as well.
They did, but not for. Like,
he only came on once, right?
I think he did. He didn't even play when France was through. Remember, they won their first two games.
Yeah. Who can they get? Who can we get? Who can they get? Who can they get? Mark Lawrence. We day. No, seriously.
I don't think they'll go. Well, I'm sure that they'll find another striker. Not for 7 million.
Where are the options? Boney for 20.
Boney, Michu was gone. Boney was one. Mandzukic went to Atletico Madrid. There's Lukaku, but I don't think Mourinho is that stupid to sell him to Liverpool.
No.
And again, these guys are looking at least 20 million.
Yeah.
While, you know, not unless I maybe have, I'm, this man's saying ridiculous, maybe Barini is the guy. Could he step up?
He hasn't been facing the games that I've stayed before.
I was listening to an interview with Jamie Carragher today, and he was talking about this whole issue. And he thought the fight that, Rodgers signed Barini because the fight that he had, not because he was a goal scorer. And I think if you're turning down a 14 million deal to Sunderland to play for your place when you're maybe the third,
he's got guts to do it. But
what was the stat when he was at Roma? It was like Oriello, Totti, and somebody else ahead of him, and it just was kind of like he was kicking and screaming. Yeah. So like, yeah, no, the guy has a lot of heart, but like, you know. I guess he scored a lot of important goals for Sunderland.
And he's a penalty taker as well. I don't know. I think it will lie somewhere else. And I think Rodgers would be very upset because it was a good goodbye. That he could have got a good, very good player for 8 million, and he was a great selling value as well.
Dan is our overlord and scriptwriter, and he's 100 million for Kevin Strootman to Man United. I haven't even heard about this.
Yeah, the Roma. You know your man Garcia, the manager.
Yes, I know him.
He came out and he said, we'll talk if there's 100 million.
But that's his decision.
No, he says he's not selling him, which I... Yeah, but then, of course, Sky Sports actually put up today £79 for Kevin Struben. So they forgot the million. So that's not like he's not worth obviously 100 million euro. But
do you think if they got a bid for like 20,
I think that honestly hold out for like 40 or something.
He's really not that great, and he was injured from February.
I heard good things.
They also said the Dutch would have done really well if he was in the middle.
I'm not saying
it's not
good. Like Roma, if you look at Roma, how well the season was going, focal point was when he got injured. You know, I'm always very dubious about signing injured.
Well, no, yeah, though they really Garcia came out and said it, and I think it's horrible. But
Well, Man United do need people. We can talk about that when we get to transfer news next. Jack Wilshere, sorry for did this not happen a long time ago?
It's happened twice now.
He
did it again in Las Vegas. He was in a hot tub with loads of women, and he was
with a bottle of Blue Wicked, and what I can only assume was a menthol cigarette.
Wait, when did this happen? This was very recent.
Did it? Yeah, it was over the weekend.
We shouldn't have to apologize.
This was my question, John. Is this just really bad luck for him in terms of being spotted? Or is he the only football player?
I think they just. That legendary picture of Jack Charlton playing for Leeds. He's just having a smoke in the middle of the match.
We're going to talk about the difference between football then.
Yeah,
and
but you know what I mean.
Well, is there anybody else now that's a known smoke? Off the top of your head.
I know Brian O'Driscoll used to smoke in the
I know Joey Barton put a cigar out in someone's eyes. So I don't
that
imagine
was the
other
man. Was it Usman Dabo?
No, but he must have cigarettes close to his thing and put them out in people's eyes. Berbatov is clearly a smoker.
He does smoke, I think.
Does he?
Yeah.
So, Jack Wilshere, I remember the last time it happened, it's very, very apologetic. What was his apology like this time?
Sorry. I think Wenger didn't want to comment. Wenger's asked about it, and Wenger's I'll deal with it internally and I'll talk to him about it. But I haven't seen it. The usual Wenger guff. I don't see why Wilshere. It's not the biggest crime in the world, but at the end of the day, you're a professional footballer. I think if anyone's now, it's easy for me to say it. Professional footballer. You should look after your body. Look at Gareth Bale, for example. For his £100 million move to Madrid or wherever it was, 90 million or something, he got his big move, and he doesn't drink, he doesn't smoke, he doesn't do anything like that. And you would have thought in 2010, when they were both coming onto the scene, Bale's a little bit older than Wilshere. But if you'd said to anyone, one of these Bale or Wilshere in 2010, when Wilshere kind of started making the introduction to the Arsenal squad, who would go to Real Madrid first? And I think everyone would have gone with a 17-year-old Jack Wilshere.
That's probably true.
Most quality. But if he's not looking at, Wilshere hasn't improved as a player. Really. Yeah. He's a good player. I mean, I'm not saying he's crap, but he's not as good as where he should be. He's one of those players who's got good and then he's just literally leveled out.
Yes.
And that's a worrying sign for us. You look at Ramsey. Ramsey's twice the player Wilshere is.
Less pressure on, though.
Well, Wilshere.
Wilshere is the only English player to get through the Arsenal Wenger U team.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, Gibbs.
Well, recently. Was Gibbs not signed?
Gibbs is already.
Alright. But I remember there was very big hope for Wilshere. He was the first player before Gibbs.
Yeah, he was seen as the future for England. Sure. As in, the only guy who can. He does have lovely balance. He does play well. But it's for the level that he's actually shown, maybe he's actually not looking at himself, and that could be a reason. So I think it is. He shouldn't be doing it if that's costing his career, you know?
Well, no, I think it's very easy for even smokers to point the finger at football players, because when you think this guy is earning this wage to show up and train, and one of the aspects of training is being fit to train, fit to perform. So it's very easy to point the finger, but at the same time, as somebody who has a smoke when I drink, right? I kind of understand the niceness of doing it semi permanent.
Yeah, but your job, you know, your job isn't to be physically top.
No, I know. I just quality, I feel it's a very strange one that just he happened to have been caught so many times.
Yeah,
because he can't be the only one.
No.
Pep Guardiola deemed unsackable by Rummenigge.
Rummenigge.
Yeah, as I said, the Bayern chairman. Is this news? I
don't think it's news. The only reason to sack a manager if you think you're getting someone better. Like, he almost went went to season unbeaten and was knocked out of the Champions League by a counter-attacking Real Madrid with Ronaldo and Bale.
Yeah,
you have to allow that.
You know, but like, no, I think it was more like what he said was like, he's unsackable, but I think he's been told he has to win the treble next year as well. Like, he's not going to be, he's been told, like, Bayern always improve every year. And they're sticking 100% behind him. But,
they're also not sticking.
No, well, I think it was just an interesting quote for a chairman to actually come out and say he's never going to be sacked.
It's but never
there, still, there is still a lot of demands at the club. For him. Like, a lot of people say actually he's actually made Bayern a lesser team. And the way he's kind of...
Damn, how is he ever going to match the season that preceded?
I thought Dortmund were actually looking at the final.
Okay. Well, irrelevant. He, you know, he had.
He did win the treble. Jamaica's, yeah.
It's very interesting to go ahead and say it about somebody, but at the same time, this is only after year one. So
and he took over a treble winning team.
Yeah, and he still won a double, and he hammered everyone, and he made Lam into a midfielder. I know we were talking about him a lot last week, but you know, who would have thought Lam? Like, we all know he was a very good player, but there's not many players you can just go in and just be a fulcrum point. When Schweinsteiger got injured last year, and go, ah, I'll do it. Like, everyone would have been thinking, like, maybe Thiago, he got injured as well. Then there was
Goethe. The big thing about him last year, he was very disappointing.
Yeah, but he struggled a lot with injuries.
He didn't get much of a chance.
Well, really. To be fair, Barca were mad not to give him a new contract and give him what he wanted.
Well, they clearly have big ideas for him this year. With Cruz being so easily let go to Madrid, I can only imagine that the four people in the midfield three, it's going to be between Schweinsteiger, Lam, Müller, and Thiago.
And Javi Martinez, is there?
Javi Martinez as well. Yeah, I think that's what they were saying.
I think Muller would be kind of probably...
Well, Muller would be the top of it, and I think he'll play behind Lewandowski, and then when fit, which actually doesn't happen that often, Ribery and Robin will be...
That's
terrifying. It is so terrifying.
I still think the Madrid five.
Do you want to talk about that now? You might as well talk about that now. Okay,
yeah.
So,
well, the number...
Yeah, go on.
The number... I think it's great. Number 7 is Ronaldo, 8 is Kroos, 9 is Benzema, 10 is James Rodriguez, and 11 is Bale.
So how is your Real Madrid team? What's your front six? That's the big question.
Well,
Who's sacrificed?
Di Maria would have to be sacrificed, probably. Well, but even though he's their best player last year.
Yeah, this is...
Nuts. You've got Modric, you've got Alonso, if Kadira stays, Di Maria,
Isco,
Ilra Mendy. It's like, who are you supposed to pick with all these guys?
I can see Benzema going.
And who plays center forward?
Benzema
tomorrow. Or
Liverpool?
I don't know.
I think he's already said that. There's a Schley one past. Okay, I'll give you mine, right? I think Modric is the one who's going to get the boot.
No,
I think he was their best player.
He was on fantastic.
I think it's because obviously he's not defensive midfielder, right? Mm-hmm. And obviously they have to show that it's a new one spent, so they have to play the new sign. So I see it being a case of Alonso holding, Cruz in the center, Ham behind Benzema, and then Ronaldo and Bale on the flanks.
I think it'll be Modric in for Alonso, and I think Kadira will go. And
so hold on.
I think Kadira will
start. Oh no, go!
I think Kadira will go.
You're saying this, the midfield three is going to be Rodriguez, Cruz, and
Modric. Modric and Cruz can kind of in somewhat sit there. Like, Cruz.
Do you want Cruz doing
that? Yeah, I don't know. I still think they need to replace Alonso because he is coming very much to the end. He's maybe, what, 34 now? And you can see at the World Cup, he was very.
It's Ancelotti. I cannot see him playing a front six that are all attacking minded players.
Alonso is still going to get Alonso or Kadira.
Well, maybe I think Alonso will play like the El Clasicos and maybe the Madrid Derby, maybe going to up to Bilbao, like hard tough places like that. Maybe going down to Sevilla.
Who was your man that kept Bale out of the team through a lot of last season? And when Bale wasn't top of one, they were giving out the young guy.
Yes,
eh? Yeah,
like, he did his cruciates. He was actually tipped for the Spain squad. Actually,
he was good. Like, good enough that I remember his name.
Yeah, Madrid though, they spend so much, but like they sold Cruz for 25 and they got the Bach Cruz for 25 and they sold Morata for 20. So they do balance the books well.
Yeah, that's a very interesting thing. They bought all these attacking players, but like primarily Cruz is a central midfielder / number 10. Rodriguez is pretty much strictly a number 10. Sure. He's kind of limited. He can't really play in the flanks. And they've sold Morata. So technically, they don't really have a backup centre forward.
Not a sick yes, I up there are.
Well, they do and they don't. Like Rodriguez and Ronaldo can both play there. I could even see.
Well, yeah, they could. Like, I think James would even play false against Inter. It was very good, wasn't it? So, yeah.
Let's stick on the Spanish thing for a while. Here's something about the Ham Rodriguez signing. They've already recouped 36 million in t-shirt sales. They've sold 3,800 t-shirts already. Well, this was on Saturday when I was making notes for the show.
It's fairly incredible, all right.
That's a pretty cheap buy then.
Yeah, well, it's the same with Beckham. Didn't they make in a week? They made it all back.
That damn Colombian market.
Yeah. They didn't make Ronaldo though, because they switched him to 9. A lot of people still had Ronaldo 9.
Yeah, but they went to CR7 then.
They went to
CR7 after a year.
Very clever. All right, wanted to talk about Messi tax evasion. Is this back in the news? Is he? What's going to happen? What's the
probably allegation? Nothing. He's not paying his tax properly, which is fine because he's probably getting too much money. I just like to think Ronaldo pays for a kid's surgery. Messi doesn't pay his taxes.
Here we go.
It was really
here,
a
we go.
First.
Here we go. Here we go. Ding ding.
Just everyone mention that song again.
Yeah, no, yeah.
No, but honestly,
no, but you know what actually happened was that this whole tax thing actually came up, right? Okay.
Sure.
The tax thing came up last year, and whoever the prosecutor was, whoever, I don't know, the supposed to be the revenue place of Spain or whatever the hell it is, they had Jorge Messi, his dad, and Lionel. Jorge Messi is supposed to look after all of his affairs, okay? After Lionel Messi's affairs. Yeah. And he said there was a problem with it then, and actually all got resolved, and then they withdrew the prosecution. But for some reason, the courts are still going ahead with this. That's what I read. I don't know what's actually happening.
All I know is when my grandkids ask me about Messi, the greatest player to play in my lifetime, what do I remember most? It'll be that he didn't pay his taxes.
Well, let's move on to the next one, because I think this is just
ridiculous. Okay, one more Barcelona note. To cement the heel turn, it seems that they've got somebody who's banned by the back porch, for lack of a better term. Suarez is getting fast-tracked to either start the season or be back just in time for El Clasico.
But the ban was stopped before the Clasico. Like, it was the fixtures were made.
No, the fixtures only came out since that. So it was catered to the idea that, oh, when's he back? Okay,
there you go. No, I do agree that, but I don't think that nothing to do with Barcelona.
Well, I think it's very favourable for Barcelona.
Oh, it is?
So do you not think there's something
going on? I think, yeah, but also, like, you get Luis Suarez, who's been probably the best number 9 the last maybe year and a half
from
world football.
Here's what I'm saying.
Have his debut against Real Madrid.
Dan, whether Luis Suarez's ban is before El Clasico, right, or whether it comes back after El Clasico, the fact that it's the week of is just a bit too much.
It is a coincidence.
I think it'll hurt Barcelona more than anything else.
Because they'll feel obliged to throw me.
Well, it happened to Real Madrid last year when they were forced to play an unfit Bale and he wasn't. But Suarez, he's banned from training.
Yeah,
and his ban ends the day before. Yeah, like
he can't even train with the B team. You know,
well, he can run around from official training sessions in the stadium. Do you think that, like, you know, a few lads
Well, not,
that, over to his,
well not unless they put him back in the La Masia. Like if the maybe the
would maybe, that, maybe like, he would send the lads down.
Maybe he wouldn't be allowed.
Danny's not allowed in.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it's a training complex. You know.
Yeah,
I don't know.
That's going to be interesting. Like, Luis Suarez, nobody loves him as a player. Really. I don't know if he just jumped into an El Clasico.
Who was that non-European team? Right? It was some like tiny team in some country. Wanted to take Suarez on loan until the ban ended.
Oh, yeah, because he's not FIFA.
They were not under FIFA jurisdiction or something.
They weren't an actual country. They were kind of a
state.
State.
Yeah. I can't remember who it was, but that was... hilarious. Like,
it was somewhere in Asia.
That would actually nearly be a good idea. Just to be training. Like,
didn't they say something like, we can pay you $2,500 a week?
Very
generous.
Very nice.
Brendan Rodgers wants improved defence. We're going to talk about the Lovren signing when we get to transfers. So besides Lovren, is there anything to note on this? Anybody else rumoured to potentially come in? Are we going to see Glenn Johnson go out. Coates has featured quite a lot in the pre-seasons, as has Enrique. Flanagan, not so much?
Yeah. What's he doing? Don't think he needs to play Flanagan. You know that.
Yeah, I think Enrique needs games.
But if Ben Johnson is Liverpool's first choice right back, I give him hope.
You know what I think he's doing? I think that no matter what, Gerrard is going to play with somebody else. I think it's either going to be Gerrard and Lucas or Gerrard and Kahn.
I thought Lucas was gone. Like,
yeah. Lucas,
did he not tweet he says goodbye or something in May?
I think that was just a mix-up image to... Yeah.
Hello and goodbye.
There hasn't been any rumours, and I'm pretty sure he's...
I think if a bid came in...
I think it would be Alan. Whatever.
Yeah, I would imagine so. No, I think it'll be similar.
15 million.
I don't honestly know. He needs to improve the defence, but he doesn't seem to be going about it unless Southampton have
If we don't get any marquee signings, like, then I can see, especially with the Lallana issue, which we'll talk about next, I can see him doing, like, kind of what he did second half of the game yesterday, where Sturridge up front, Sterling and Coutinho on the flanks, and then maybe Henderson in front of two holding players.
It might work. I don't think you can rely on Sturridge. He's a great player, but he'll miss at least a third season.
Oh, what do you mean?
Injuries. And I don't honestly know. We're doing our planned our predictions for the seasons in the coming weeks, and unless something magical happens, I don't think it's looks good.
It's a lot. Like, John, what are we? We're on the 29th of July. We've got 1 month.
But we lost out in the Remy deal.
I know the Remy deal is annoying, but...
No, but we lost out in the Remy deal, and the first people we're supposed to get is Rodriguez. The Southampton thing, I feel sorry for Eddie Southampton.
I think he's going to Spurs. He's going to Spurs. Him and Schneiderlin. So Southampton have literally sold about...
They sold the club for 174 million, and if the Schneiderlin and Rodriguez deal...
Yeah,
that's going on.
Yeah, so we kind of touched on it there. Lallana is going to miss the opening game. He's not actually going to miss that much time, though. I don't believe. And just a final note on the pool, I guess, is that, as bad as it looks, I still think we strengthen the squad. And, this time last year, even though we had Suarez and Virgil, our marquee signings were Aspas, Saka, and
Alberto.
So there you go. And Nick Clegg, the Deputy Prime Minister, this Russia gimmick. He basically wants England to pull out the World Cup in Russia.
No, he wants Russia stripped of them.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. I think the England thing is also sort of...
No, he wants England to get it, which I think... There's the next two World Cups, right?
They could be a disaster.
Russia, with what's going on over there, well, again, it's 4 years' time, we don't know, and especially Qatar, that's going to be an absolute mess in 2022. So there's three countries, in my view, who should be top of the list for those two, and they should be making a decision. England, I definitely think should get one, because they've got... The fans have really behaved in the last maybe 10 years. There's been such a massive change in the culture of the kind of hooliganism.
It really has.
I mean, to be fair, they're really good. Like, I think that was also why a lot of people hated England as well. It's like I remember my dad went to Wembley in 1981, 32 for England and Ireland. And they got off the bus and like all the English fans, like they started throwing rocks at the bus. Like they were... Like, it was just like an actual Irish bus, like, during one of those tours, and like, he was actually fairly frightened. There was a lot of rioting going on with the Englishmen, and they started beating the crap out of each other. Which is the usual stuff. So, what they should do is give it to England or Germany, and I definitely give one in 2022 to the United States. I'd bring it back there after 94. The way things are going in that country, with like, Beckham, Henry, Robbie Keane, all the lads going over there, I think 2022 in the States could be absolutely massive. And I think you'd get a massive superpower in the States. I think it'd be a great idea, because in 94 no one knew what was going on.
I really like that idea, and either way I see there being a well over 50% chance that one of the two upcoming World Cups are going to be switched.
I think it won't be Russia. It won't be Russia. It's too close. But Germany or England could hold it right now if they have to.
Oh yeah, no, not
because they've got the facilities and they've got like perfect transport. They know how to organise it. Like,
if we actually had two more stadiums here, Wales, Scotland, and Ireland would be for it, because they've got a few up in Scotland, and then you've got the Cardiff.
You'd have three in Scotland: Hanover Park, Ibrox, and Celtic Park. You'd have the Millennium Stadium. You'd have Croker and Aviva here. Yeah. And then you'd be looking, maybe if you could get Tolman Park.
You need a bit two more.
Like, Tolman Park.
It'd be so interesting.
Dude, after the trouble here at Crow Park already this year, like, said you could have three games.
there'll be no fine. Okay, so, yeah, Sam Allardyce's odds of being the first manager out were slashed this week. What's causing all this, as Ric Flair would say, and is this a good move for West Ham to make? I know it's they signed the Argentinian
Zarate,
and Allardyce had nothing to do with it.
No, but he was told last year, before the end of the season, that he wants Scholes and some of them, I think there are a few lads there, they want attractive football at West Ham, and you don't know the West Ham way. And essentially, he was told that if you can keep your job if you can get that going. And the Revel Morrison thing, Allardyce doesn't rate him. He doesn't like his attitude, maybe. I think a lot of people probably would agree. But Golden Sullivan see him as an asset and somebody who can attack and dribble and do whatever. And Allardyce wants him out. And they want to keep him. And there was a tweet there with Gold on Monday saying, I think someone tweeted him something like, oh yeah, first manager, when's Allardyce leaving or something? And Gold favourite.
Okay.
So it was something along those lines. Anyway, it's like his odds have been, he's like odds on now to be sacked. And like,
yeah, I'll probably leave it too late.
Like, but Martin O'Neill, I remember, got sacked in 2010-11 season. He got sacked after the first game. No, he had a disagreement with Randy Lerner.
Oh, yeah.
Or was it?
That's because he wanted money, and Randy Lerner was like,
yeah, but he left after the first game, so it isn't. But that's. Like, DiCanio left in August last year. He wouldn't have left in August.
No. Eight games in.
Was it? September, was it? Yeah. But it was early enough, you know, like, they do happen.
It does happen, but,
you know, it wouldn't surprise me.
Just if they're going to do it, they should do it now.
To be honest, I don't think anyone would crap it was, so, yeah, kind of irrelevant.
Oh, I do have a West Ham fan friend, and
Sam
Allardyce,
so.
Yeah. I think all West Ham fans, so
yeah, I hate them.
Too. Yeah, but, like, he's kept them up every year. Like, they're not very good.
Well, that's his kind of fault. And as much abuse as Liverpool get for 35 million Andy Carroll, they got 18 or 24. Has he played for West Ham yet? Just constantly injured.
Well, they lost a lot of
men. And Joe Cole.
I like
Sam Allardyce, frankly. He plays a lot of Liverpool's nonsense.
Okay, I want
to expect to see Barini in the West Ham games.
Glenn Johnson. Go back to West Ham. He started, didn't he?
I would love it. I would blow Sam Allardyce to get rid of Glenn Johnson.
Okay. We're getting close to it. It's not quite a beat, but we're getting close to it.
We're only, 27 minutes in?
Yeah, exactly. Before we get to transfer news, I want to talk about something John brought up, which is the predictions, all right? So here's how it's going to go down, my friends. I'm going to make this interesting. We're going to predict who you think is going to get relegated in a couple of weeks' time, and that is what it is. In terms of the top of the table, we are going to predict our top six. But a slight caveat is we are going to get a bye, which means that you can pick, after you make your top six, you can pick one kind of bracket to switch. So if you think first and second is going to be really close, you could switch your two names there. Think third and fourth. Yeah. So for instance, if I say my top four is, I think it's going to be Chelsea, Liverpool, Arsenal, City, I'm going to have my little switcheroo, my roller room retake as 2 and 3, because I think there's a good chance Arsenal might come second as well. Yeah. So you can do that when it's all said and done. Maybe that will be enough to make you the winner. And the winner will get a night on the town, right? Sponsored by the other two members of this podcast. And we're going to bring microphones and we're going to document this night out at the end of the season.
Oh, Christ.
So are we all in?
Yeah, go for it. Where are we going? €2 dices on a Sunday, is it? Or?
Yeah. All the listeners can meet us there. All right. Dan, go through the transfer news for us there.
The big one kind of today is Callum Chambers with a surprise £60 million move to Arsenal.
Sorry, listeners, I don't know who he is either.
But it's bizarre that they bought Debuchy for £12 million. And now they're buying another right back. Now, I know he can fill in a centre back, and they rate him highly as a centre, but it's kind of another.
He has to start. You can't buy.
Oh, no, Debuchy will start.
I know, but you can't buy defenders for that amount of money and not play them.
Sure, didn't he buy Walcott for about 15, 16?
Yeah, but
in 2006, and he didn't play him for, well, he went to World Cup without playing a game.
No, he played him. His first game, his debut was like a Carlo Cup final, wasn't it?
Oh no, he played one or two games. That was a year or two after. Like, he didn't play for about nearly a year for Arsenal. He just took him in the reserves.
I just don't think he can do it with defenders. No, defenders need to play. Unless he's going straight out on loan.
which send them back to Southampton, but they're getting rid of them. I don't know.
This next one here killed me dead. David Ospina, the Colombian keeper, to Arsenal for $3 million, which first off is an absolute bargain. He's an awesome keeper, even though he's kind of short. He's an awesome keeper. And like, this is just like Arsenal, you know, have great keepers now. Man City have a choice between Hart and Willie.
Oh, amazing, yeah.
I don't
know. Hart and Willie?
Every day I make that choice. But the fact is, long story short, if we don't keep Pepe Reina to create opportunity and create competition for that spot, what is the big issue with having two goalkeepers?
Because Reina's on about $100,000 a week.
Brad Jones is...
And he's a bit of an arsehole.
And he loves Rafa a bit too much.
He doesn't like Rodgers.
Definitely doesn't like
Rodgers. I don't see Reina saying there, and I think it'd be stupid.
He had a lot of press talk when he was away, like badminton Liverpool, and how they wouldn't win the league. Mingale wasn't trusted with him, which technically isn't.
When he cost you the game at the City, the match at City.
It's very strange for Pepe Reina.
That's one mistake. I think you'd look at every single goalkeeper in the top four. I can't imagine.
You see, Neil, like, I know you might be a fan of Reina, but I don't know if you thought about like being a business sense. No, who I has $100,000 a week keeper on the bench? He'd play maybe four matches a year.
Okay, regardless about Reina and his wages, yeah? And that's fair. I wish we had signed Ospina.
Oh, yeah.
That's kind of what I'm saying. I'd love if we had competition for
Reina. Well, I don't know what the difference of Arsenal is this year. They've really like took the finger out. And they're buying... But they need. They still need to buy a striker, and they still need a defensive midfielder.
The shirts thing is a huge part.
If they can get that sorted, they are serious title contenders. And I know you're against Wenger. He's injured again.
Wenger's against himself.
No, he's getting injured listening to the podcast.
Which is Bojan to Stoke, John?
I think it's kind of madness. But a lot of people are like, he played with Messi and Eto and all them. He must be great. Like he's done nothing at Roma, as far as I know.
No.
And there's a reason he's going to Stoke. He's not still at Barcelona, who keep everyone.
Well, Barca were trying to get rid of him for a few years. They kept loaning him out. Like, he's at Ajax. He's at Roma. He's been literally... Who wants Bojan? He wants to pay for him. No one. And then I don't know how he even got money off him. He must have run a bit of fight.
Like, I know he was on the bench the last time Barca won the Champions League.
In 2005, like he's a little bit older than... Is he older than this?
I don't know.
No, he's younger, is he?
I think so.
I think he's actually younger.
Yeah.
But he came out of the B team, the C team, about 2005, 2006, kind of around the same time as Messi, kind of. And he was like, he scored like 35 goals every year in the B team. He was really like, he was banging them in, and they all thought this guy, give him a chance for the goal, but he never really.
They made no great shakes. No. Like, if you look at this, that's amazing, the clubs that he has been a part of, when you look at Barcelona, Roma, Milan, Stoke. And take the next one, Dan.
I just wanted to see, can you play in a cold Thursday night at Stoke? Last thing about Messi, you'll find out about Bojan.
I didn't actually know about this player
that Barcelona bought. Is he good?
Well, he's just ridiculously. I think he's old. Yeah.
He's okay, but the odd thing about this one is, right?
That Barcelona are banned from transfer.
Well, no, they're not. Suspended. Matthew is the first centre-half they've bought in 5 years.
Because Mash wasn't bought as a...
They haven't bought a centre-half in 5 years. They've had Alex Song and Mascherano fill in sometimes.
Yeah.
And they've relied on PK, Poyol and Mascherano who have bought, and Abidal sometimes when he's gone. I can't believe it. This is the first guy since their biggest flop. Capriario was only flop, really. Dimitro Kruginski? Anyone remember him?
Nope.
Half him in the back of my jersey.
Yeah. Bought for $25 million or something off Shakhtar, and then was loaned out 6 months later or something, or a year later, and released pretty much nothing.
Would Ibrahimovic not be Guardiola's biggest flop?
Yes.
Yeah, he would be, actually.
It's a lot of money.
It was, but no, it's
like $40 million in Eto or something?
$50 million
in Eto or something?
Yeah, but well, no, he fancy. Eto was a bit of a bad egg.
Yeah.
And they tried to actually offload him with Ronaldinho and Deco and Nielsen. Year before, but Eto said, I'm not leaving. So he said, look, if you play by my rules, you can stay for one more year. He won the Champions League, he won the treble, first Spanish team to ever win the treble.
Yeah.
And he shipped him out to Ibrahim, which is bizarre, but it didn't work out. But yeah, Matthew, he's okay, but I think they're still looking for. They didn't hand him the number 5 jersey, which I think is crucial because he's handed number 24, I think.
Okay.
So they still have number 5 vacant after Poyol left. So I still think they're looking for another main centre half. So I don't think.
Tired?
No.
Toddy's 10 is from
the Beagle Park. Toddy's
10? It's a big thing in Italy now. You can understand it. They play there for a lot longer.
I don't think
no, Poyol is amazing, but no, he they won't retire that. And I think they want someone like Hummels or Marquinhos or Miranda, maybe, Atletico. I think so. There are options, and I still think they'll nick one before this goes.
I'm the one who didn't want to talk about Liverpool all day, but I think I'd be okay with us retiring the number 8 and seeing Gerrard retire.
Yeah. Why not? Okay, speaking of Liverpool next there, John.
I'm pretty happy with this. When we were rating Southampton at the start of the summer, as it was rumoured, Lovren and Lallana were who I wanted.
Yeah.
He's young, decent centre-back, seems like a bit of a leader. I think it's exactly what we missed last season, so...
Him and Saka?
I think so,
because he's right-sided.
Yeah. No, he's left-sided.
Is he?
Yeah.
He's got 3 left-sided centre-halves.
Yeah.
Is he not right-sided?
No.
God.
Yeah, see, this is...
That's odd. Because you need... Like, I know it doesn't make much of a difference, but you want good balance. Like, you have Skrtel on one side.
I think honestly, like, Johnson, Agger, and Lucas, if there was
money. That's been going for a while.
Yeah.
What is?
You said Johnson, sorry?
If money had come in at the stage for Agger, Johnson, or Lucas, I think we would have taken it off, but I don't think anything's come in that we want. Or
Reina.
Or, yeah. Well, Napoli want Reina, but they know that we don't want them, so they're bidding.
They got to go to Sanchez.
Right, if they don't have Reina.
Yeah.
Okay, Griezmann to Atletico at 30 million. It's just him and Valbuena were the two kind of French standouts. Fast people on the wings. He's awesome.
He's very good at
You could see them selling him for more in a season or two anyway. So
yeah, he really stood out in the last 2 years with Sociedad. And like Sociedad, like he was the team we got them to top 4. And he was part of that really good team with like Xavi Prieto. Bravo, the goalkeeper. He's since gone to Barcelona to fight out for number 1. They had actually Carlos Vela. Like, they had some really good players that year, Sociedad, and you know, they have to balance the books, don't they? So but it's a big big move for him, and I think he'd be good there. I think because Christian Rodriguez is going hurt as well. He's leaving, so he'll take his spot as a kind of a wide man.
So. And the hotly tipped youngster, 36 years old, Didier Drogba, has made his big signing to Chelsea. Finally hit the big time. This is an amazing move, I think. This is just incredible. Although I don't think he actually looked good at all last year when he saw Galatasaray play.
I think he's there more. He's going to be a long coach. Maybe. He's only going to be a year contract, isn't
he? The first thing I said to John when we signed is just the idea of like a pretty physical game and the defence already being a bit battered around by Costa, and then him coming on with Costa for the last 20 minutes.
Mm.
It could be lethal.
Well, I don't know about you, but I'd rather have Lukaku over Drogba.
No, I'd rather...
I think there's more fear.
He's already half his age.
I know he is, but you know, I would keep Lukaku and get rid of Torres. I'd have Lukaku, Drogba, and
Costa. Sorry, did anyone see Torres' miss?
No.
Oh my god. I don't know who it was on the left. It might have been Salah or someone like that, or...
Well, he was definitely playing.
And he was down the left, and he cut it back, and Torres was about 2 yards out, and all he did was chest in the goal, and he chested it over the bar. It was one of these, it's just Torres is at it again.
Is he going?
He's...
They
got Mandzukic. Yeah, there's they got Mandzukic and Griezmann. Like, that
in that interview that I mentioned earlier with Jamie Carragher, the Anfield Rap podcast, lads, for Liverpool fans, it's well worth a listen.
Plug there. Thank you. Appreciate that.
They will. They need it.
Well, listen to us first.
But they interviewed Jamie Carragher, and he said the question was basically, how will Liverpool, like, how did you react when Liverpool saw the big players like Michael Owen and Torres? Now, need a little dig at Torres, and he goes, everyone noticed that Torres is downhill for 18 months, but thankfully the football world didn't. Yeah. Like, 15 million was just...
I heard him saying that there was balls in training that he'd crib about if they didn't play to feet, where when he first came in, he'd run for them, and stuff that he was just off pace and stuff.
Yeah,
they knew internally.
Yeah.
Well, this is a ridiculous drop line.
It is ridiculous.
But I think every Liverpool fan was very upset that they left. I think they were more upset when Torres left than Suarez.
That's because it was such a bad place. 14th in the table with Roy Hodgson.
So you were 17th for a while, weren't you?
Yeah.
16, 17?
Yeah.
You lost to Wolves at home?
If Remy had gone, I could have seen Keith Jordan making me sneaky for him. Because he lives in London anyway. You know? Why not? Keith Jordan. Alright, so let's transfer over to some close to home action. League of Ireland teams in Europe this week. We spoke last week about St. Pat's having a great draw against Liège Warsaw. But
they got my hopes up so much.
You guys watched this, because this is a mauling
fight. The first half
Pat's did okay. They did okay.
Until they conceded.
And then they conceded. And then there was no leadership. Like, I don't know where Fahy was.
I think the situation got to them. I don't know if they got too excited and they were like, if we get a draw here, we're true, or something like that. Because they set up for a draw and they were not happy.
It didn't help. It really didn't. They needed to go into a draw. A bad pitch. You know, having to shed there, like having
a kip of the stadium.
No offense to Shakora, but like, that's what they needed. So bring them to Richmond Park and really show these guys what, you know, it's tough. And I think they respected Warsaw far too much.
They had one chance that was a deflection.
Fahy had a shot.
Fahy, yeah.
And, but the problem
he
was...
He looked great. I thought he was doing it, he do it himself.
At halftime, I think his class player, Chris Forrester, went off at halftime. He's injured and they replaced him with... We discussed him last week, Mark Quigley, who did not try a leg, as usual. He's the guy who said he'd rather retire than sit on the bench at Pats.
I don't think he'll be missed.
He's the most talented player in the league, but he just doesn't give a shit. And when he brought him on, they put him left wing, and he didn't track. And Warsaw just had far too much for him. As soon as they got that, then the second goal went in, after about maybe it was around the hour mark, they went riot. And then Joe O'Brien, who was one of the leaders of the team, he went off injured and brought Sean Hoare on, and Hoare really was all over the place.
I think they were just devastated. I think as soon as that second goal went in, was it 2 minutes at halftime?
No.
It was 1-0. When the second goal went in, you could just see them go.
Yeah, well, the Pats were just trying to hold them out to maybe get 1-0 in the last 10 minutes. But it was 5-0, and to be honest, it didn't flatter them. And it was kind of almost funny, like, you know, the end. Everyone was up for them, but then it was like 5-0. Let's just kind of laugh. It was just
the first legs had got such great results for the Irish teams, and I was like, we might get a bit of crack here. Like, starting the podcast, following an Irish team, and this kind of like, this is dreadful.
Yeah. Well, let's continue on. So Sligo, who had won the first leg encounter 2-1 against Rosenberg, they lost the second leg 3-1, so 4-3 overall. I saw this.
And they went 1-0 up through Danny North. And I was like, these guys are going to do it.
Wow.
And
so it was 3-1 on aggregate.
It was 3-1 on aggregate with 2 away goals, and they fucking blew it in the second half.
So what's the crack with people coming over here?
Do you think they just get a look at the stadiums and they're like, ah, come on.
I can't lose, especially not here.
The
first two stadiums we mentioned are Tala and the Showgrounds. They're actually probably one of the best ones around.
Yes.
I think they just had too much for them, to be honest. Like, Rosenberg are a good team for, like, to be playing Europa League second round qualifier. Like, they were actually a pretty decent team to play against. And, it's just annoying because they scored and then they conceded soon after. I think if they could have held on maybe longer, it could have been different. But, they did okay, but, they just really, there was a lot of huff and puff, you know.
I do indeed. Shakhtar, what's this? Solly Gorsuch?
You couldn't pronounce it last week either.
Yeah.
Against Derry.
And you won't have to pronounce
it again. Yeah, and they won 1-0 at, they went 1-0 at the Brandywell. And again, of course, as this is the theme of the night, League of Ireland teams getting their hopes up, Michael Duffy put them in front in the first 10 minutes.
Right.
And it was like, oh, Derry have a chance here. And no, they lost 5. So,
we did have one team go through.
No, we didn't have one team go through.
No, Dan has just written this.
Oh, I wrote it the wrong way. Excuse me. We didn't have one. No, but they lost. They lost. Sorry, that's just typo. And you're the anchor. You should have known.
Well done to Dundalk for going through the next leg of the opening.
Yeah, I know.
No, they but an amazing win against Hadrick Smith. They went 1-0 down, and they came back and won 2-1 second half. Goals from Pat Hogan and Curtis Burr, and they were applauded off the pitch by the Smith fans. Oh. And like they lost 2-0 at Oriel Park, and they went there and won 2-1. So if they got one more goal, they were through, and they just ran out of time. But they played really, really well, and they're the best team in the league by far. And I don't know.
The closest, so you'd want to be.
Well, they just blew it at Oriel Park. If they hadn't conceded 2 away goals, it's always difficult to come back from. I know Sligo did it, and they didn't through, but it's always, and Split were always a decent team. Especially got to Croatia, it's a tough trip over there, you know.
Absolutely. So, John, you've seen a few of these matches, you know, in preparation for doing the show. You wanted to see what the, as you said, you know, be great excitement while covering these teams, you know, coincides with the start of our podcast. That's, how far can they go? What, like, you know, it's not like their opponents are any great shakes either. So what's the crack?
I just think a few of them bottled it. I think Pats are maybe the worst of it. I think they, in the first leg, they just went out there to have, playing, you know, European football night, have fun with it like they did, and they got a win, they were very happy, and then they found out they get another leg against Celtic if they win here, and they just maybe try to get more tactical than they should have. Like, if they went out there kicking,
to be fair to Pats, I think the killing goal was the goal they conceded in Warsaw.
That's true.
In the 91st minute. If they had taken a 1-0 victory, and they were well worth their win, because there was actually one stage of the match where Pats had 7 shots on target, while Warsaw on the first leg only had like 2. So like they really were, you know, you can't say they weren't worth. Like they played great counter-attack of football, and like Safahi played really well, and Kohlenberg and Fagan was on the threat of him. But I don't know, I think that it just kind of got to them, and I think as well, when there's expectation, this country can kind of get carried away.
But it was, I was watching it with 2 diehard Rovers fans, and they were cheering for Pats.
Like, same here. Yeah, I was cheering for
really?
Yeah. Oh yeah, well,
that's good.
Well, now there's a few people who won't. To go all the way to support my team. But the majority of people, like, I was up for all those teams. And, you know, because it's some point, if someone can get through, like what Rovers did in 2011, that's what's never going to be emulated again.
Yeah.
Well, even Rovers were lucky. Rovers were going out before a ridiculous volley, one of the legs that got them through.
We played really well over there.
I know,
yeah. It was one of the goals. It's one of the greatest goals you'll ever see. I don't know if you saw it.
It's well worth
it. By Pat Sullivan.
Well worth a YouTube.
It was a corner came in, and it was headed out. And Sullivan was about 30 odd yards out, and he hit it first time with his right foot, straight into the corner. That got it too, because we had a 1-1 draw at Tala. And everyone's like, oh, they're not going to go to Belgrade. Like, Partizan Belgrade were the Serbian champions.
You sure?
So, like, that's tough now. Like, it's the Serbian champions. And, so Irish champions will be Serbian champions. And they went there, and they got a 1-1. And then, extra time went through, and Stephen O'Donnell scored a late penalty. And, they really, really played well. And it's so hard seeing, looking back at how poor Rovers are now. But, for what happened there in the 2011 year in the Europa League run was incredible how they got there in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Let alone what they did there. They didn't even, they weren't the kind of whipping boys of the group. They lost all their games. But they tried so hard, and they really gave a good account of themselves, as I say. Like, they weren't losing 5-6-0 every game.
Sure.
You know, which is good. Like, you know, but like, even in Shells in 2004, they get so close. They held Deportivo for nearly 120 minutes at 0-0. And, Keith Fahey was actually playing that. No, was he? No. Sorry, I'm thinking, Wes Hoolan was playing that day, excuse me. And, like, they had some good players in that Shells team. And, who was it? Alan Moore, he's a former Irish international. He was playing as well that day.
Mm-hmm.
And, he was clean through, in the Riazor. And he hit straight at the keeper. If he was, if they had gone 1-0 up, they were only half an hour away from the Champions League.
That's quite incredible.
Like, I was at that match in Lansdowne Road. The first game, and Deportivo had like the great players like Jalminio, Mauro Silva, Tristan might have played, Roy Mackay, who up in the back, Cesar, Maybeth, and Pablo. They were some really good players.
Mm-hmm.
And, I think like they won the league maybe a year or two before that. You know, and it just, it'll never be done again. And it is a shame, but we need to need investment, and that's what's going to have to happen. In my view, anyway.
Yeah, well, you definitely do. And let's talk about the domestic league. Start off with Rovers.
Yay!
They lost to draw. So as you were saying, you know, how things used to be, how things are now. Draw, they're going into this game with the new manager.
No. It was appointed after.
Okay, so talk about the match and talk about Drogheda's new manager.
Yeah, well,
Before we do that, I just like to, I made fun of Drogheda for conceding 50 goals last week.
Mm-hmm.
And I checked the table, and they're still only conceded 50 goals.
And they've scored 1 more goal.
Well,
and 3 more points.
I would just also say to all the Rovers fans listening, you boo them off at halftime and then cheer them back onto the pitch. Make up your mind.
They booed the manager off. They booed the manager off. The players came out. They applauded them out. Crawley came out and they booed him. Essentially, Rovers were awful. Awful. Like, it's one of the worst. Like, I was at the...
You were there, right?
I was at their last... I wasn't at the Pats game because I was at that wedding.
That wedding.
That wedding. So, well, no, I enjoyed the wedding, but no, it was like, we actually beat Pats at home 2-1.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, is that the catalyst that can finally kick us on in our home form? And I've been at the last 3 of the 4 games other than that, and we've lost all of them by scoring a goal. Like, that's poor.
Sorry, I'm just thinking about the wedding. John, did you hear about what happened to me and Dan at the end of the night at that wedding?
I did not.
All right. I don't.
I think this is a special we have to put out for.
No, it's not. So what happened was Dan was telling Trey today that there is this ghost that, like, you know, haunted the castle we were at. We were at Kinnison Castle, and we agreed at the end of the night that we were gonna, you know,
bear in mind, this is like, about 5:30.
Yeah,
we were drinking about 12 o'clock that day.
I did too.
You don't need to tell people that you were drinking all day when you said you're going to go ghost hunting at night. It's not like, you know what would make this wedding more interesting.
So you know, one of those things we say at the end of the night, you never talk about it. But anyway, we made it through the day, we made it through the reception, we made it through the residence bar. It was a clusterfuck. There was one of those nights where, like, 3 times I was ready to say goodnight to people. Kind of night. And I was just like, oh, maybe I'm not. And
I nearly got kicked out of the hotel.
At the very end of the night, we said, oh, well, look, we've outlasted everybody. Let's do it, right? So we went up and went to this back area hotel that Dan's dad previously told us earlier had the Mr. Ghost in it. And we turned off.
I turned off all the lights. I kept turning them back on after me.
We were walking in the halls and turning off all the lights in the castle. And all we heard your minds were at Dan's head, the lights going on. And he literally goes, you need to go to bed. We need to leave.
Right? I just thought, when he turned off the lights, where I said, I'm looking for ghosts.
So the next thing, we were kind of starting to behave ourselves. But we heard these people coming by, and they were actually relations of Dan's, who were also at the wedding. And we said, oh, geez, we can't let them see us. Because for some reason, we thought they'd automatically know that we were doing something stupid, like looking for ghosts. So there was this little kind of entree that, like, you know, room service used. And we hid behind that and thought that we would be hidden, even though our legs were clearly on. We were bent.
Your legs were.
Well, my legs were not being so ugly. So we literally are sticking there, not saying a word to each other. Our heads bent over behind this little bus trolley. And they go into their room eventually. And as we're walking away, we're like, well, I got away with that. And this door flies open. Now, remember, we're looking for ghosts. The door flies open, and then they're standing there going, what the fuck are you guys doing behind that tray? Are you giving each other blowjobs? Just don't go ghost hunting.
And listeners, if you wanted a metaphor for the Irish teams in Europe, drunken ghost hunting is.
Yeah. So, yeah, what were we talking? Oh, yeah, pass. Let's
I'm not going to make the podcast.
Yeah, okay. But anyway, yeah, that was the only game that they've won in ages. But anyway, in the meantime, Drogheda have actually named a surprise, really surprising appointment. Like, they should have just kept Darius Kearns there because he's doing such a great job. He's just come in.
So he's still assistant, you said?
He's assistant now, but Damien Richardson's in, who hasn't managed a team in, like, Cork might have been his last team. It's about 6-7 years ago. He managed Rovers. He's a couple of spells at Cork. He's been around. He's on the Soccer Republic show. Okay. A few times, it's a bizarre one, to be honest. He's new manager, Drogheda.
Dan, I have to bring it up. Sorry to interrupt you there. It's just the second time you've done it today where you announced something like it was wrestling. The first one was like, 2022, we go back to the USA, we bring it back. And the second one was like, and Drogheda, what a surprise announcement, their new manager. It's like,
hyperbole to make the Irish League sound important.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I'm not saying
it's very important. Thanks, listeners. We appreciate your thoughts.
Bohemians and Cork, did you see this?
I didn't see it, no. But I was actually at Rovers, and word of broke that it was 2-0 close.
Okay.
And Dundalk, Cork, Rovers, and Pats are challenged for the league.
Sure.
And it's like, okay, Cork are 2-0 down here, guys. Against our biggest rivals, we're actually going Cork, or down 2-0 against Bowles. Bowles haven't won a game at home all season.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, come on, what's going on? And there was no response from Rovers fans, and that's why, it was Beattie and Owen Weirin got the goals there. But the major part was Brian Lenehan, actually, Cork player.
He's been released from hospital.
Yeah, he's been released, but he's been linked with Arsenal, actually, and a few English clubs, so he is actually a very good young player. He he landed very awkwardly, and he landed, I think, on the back of his neck or his head. And apparently he just lie there. He didn't move, but his waist down was spasming everywhere.
Oh, dear. And, a stinger, was it?
Yeah, it was really poor. And he, like, doctors from physios and everything from both ends. And it was like a 10-minute delay. He was stretched out on oxygen, and people, like, thought he was paralyzed in there or broken his neck. But he's out of hospital, and apparently he won't be fit for the Pats game, but possibly two or three weeks' time he'll be back.
Like, what exactly was it?
It was a bad concussion.
Oh.
Yeah. Fuck. So, look, at least he's, apparently he's okay, which is the main thing, but, yeah, very nasty thing to see on the field, you know, you don't like to see it. But apparently, well done to all the physios, they apparently have the doctors are really well. So,
Sligo 2, Limerick 0, and Sean Maguire and Danny North with the goals for Sligo.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean for Limerick season?
Well, it's, new manager in there, Martin Russell, and he lost his first game, but I don't think he's going to go to Sligo and win. But a good bounce back for Sligo after their Europa. And Pats again, they beat Athlone, but Athlone played really well. Apparently, they played really well. Chris Forrester and Sean Hoare got the goals. And Athlone played really, really well and are battling really well. Like, the whole thing about Athlone, they're playing better than Rovers. Okay. And Athlone are, what are they, 6-7 points adrift of everyone.
That's incredible.
So, they apparently Athlone are well worth the draw. Going to get it. And Derry's, recent surge without, our friend, YMCA, 6-1, another 6-1. So they've scored like, they've scored a ridiculous amount of goals since he's left. So,
it's Duffy's birthday, isn't it?
Was it?
Yeah.
Oh, very good. So yeah, 3 for Duffy, 2 for Patterson, the guy, the striker they brought back. He was top scorer last season in the League of Ireland, and Roddy Collins actually dropped for this year. And Malloy finished, and Benson got a consolation for UCD. But it's Derry have also released more of their Roddy Collins squad. Mm-hmm. So the Rod squad is really breaking up now. With former Dave Elibert was released, so they've got rid of like 5 of his players since he's released.
Sure.
He's been sacked, which is, it just does a lot, doesn't it? Maybe he's bringing his own kind of faction in there, and they're playing much better, Derry, and they've got Rovers in 2 weeks, and I'm not looking forward to that. So,
the last score then was Dundalk 5 and Bray 1.
Yeah. More goals for Hoven and more goals for Burn after they got to Europe, 2 each for them. And the best player in the league, which is how opened it after about 60 seconds. So, Ismail Akinade, the big lad up front for Bray, got one back. But, yeah, Dundalk, they're your champions before this. And Dundalk and Cork are next Friday at Turner's Cross, Turner Cork.
Is that the last game of the season?
No. There's still a lot left, but it could come down to that. Like, you know, if you look at the league, like, there's Dundalk are 4 points ahead. If they can win that, Cork are very good at home. Like, they've been averaging great attendances this year. It's been great to see Cork coming back, but they could go 7 points there.
Okay.
So,
I didn't catch any of the League of Ireland this weekend, as you can tell by my input for the last few minutes.
I thought you'd gone home.
But I did notice that when I was looking up the results and all that sort of stuff, that 3 teams conceded in the first 10 minutes and then just went on to lose by fairly big scores, by 2 of them anyway. Did they just give up?
UCD and Bray are kind of really...
Yeah, they just give up and they were like...
Meh. Well, they I don't know, like, UCD are one of those teams, like, they'll always just try to score you. I know the table might not suggest that. They haven't scored as many, but they're kind of one of those games, like, I think they had a 5-3 victory over Bray earlier in the Carlisle ground sort of thing. Like, UCD are one of those teams, like they're kind of good to watch, like, to be honest. Like, you better value watching them than watching going up to Salah Stadium. Like, you're going to get a few goals, to be honest, like, you know.
I'm going to have my first Bill Hurley moment, though. I'm not going to say the podcast, because God knows what happened last week, but I will say this episode. Okay, so there's 12 teams in the league.
There are.
Yeah. So, if you were to play everybody twice, that'd be 22 games, right?
Yeah, but no, you play them 3 times.
That was my question. How does that work?
Yeah. You play them home. So, if I play, say Rovers are playing...
Home away and a new... Is it?
No, you play like, the season is starting back...
it's the neutral.
Go on. They've, for example, Rovers' final game of the round of fixtures against Limerick next week.
Okay.
So then they will go and play again. It will be Derry then the following week. So Derry will be the start of the final round again.
Yeah, but where the, is it home, away, and...
Home.
But that's impossible for every team.
Because... Like, no. Rovers played Derry at the start, home.
Sure.
Then they played them away to Brandywell.
Yeah.
And then they'll go and play them home again.
That means
Derry can't play.
Yeah, then Derry. That means Derry didn't play Rovers twice in their home.
Yeah, that's the way it works. It's just it is a bit ridiculous, but it's when we've only got a 12-team league.
It's kind of like
now what they should be doing is they should really split the league.
It's kind of like what Sky Sports did with the Scottish League. It's like, here's Celtic and Rangers, followed by Celtic and Rangers.
Yeah, but no, but they really actually
some
should.
Reason it'd always be
they should split Celtic the league from say Bowles down to Athlone, and then have Derry onwards upwards. And then they can split it after the two rounds of fixtures, and then they can play each other twice or something, or I don't know, something like that. It would make more sense because then.
Is there a second league?
There is, but it's shallow.
But within the second division.
Longford are good enough. Longford will get
put on. I'm right by saying within the second division, you've got like B teams of these
two. No, teams, no. There's only one B team, it's Rovers. Rovers are paying €80,000 a year to enter that team. They're not doing anything, but they're. It's not really their results. They can't get promoted.
Well, now that the sneaky third set of fixtures has been revealed to me, Cork and Dundalk clearly is a huge game next week.
Yes, it is, but they will also play each other again. Because it's the second round.
This is fucking ridiculous. I'm sorry. Okay, go through the league there.
But John, do you want to do this? If you can read, you can do it.
I think he can. It's just like
dig in,
too much abuse about Rovers there.
Dundalk on 49 points.
Sorry, John.
Into
the mic there.
I'm actually reading it into my score. Into the table here. Surprisingly, you can't hear me. Cork on 46. Big game, obviously, this week. Dundalk on open 6-point gap. Pats on 40 points. Rovers also on 40 points, despite Dan thinking they're the worst team in the league.
They are the worst team in the league.
11 points down are Sligo. On 29, Derry on 27, Bowes on 24, Drogheda, who had a stunning win against Shamrock Rovers.
To be honest, they actually deserved it as well, this whole thing.
Limerick on 20, UCD and Bray on 17, and Athlone on 11.
Lovely stuff. Dan, you know, now that I know that each team plays each other seven times, like Shamrock was good.
Yeah, well, they're 9 points behind.
Well, you're hoping for a court win next week.
That's three wins against Athlone Town.
Yeah.
Well, we can play them one more time.
Okay.
Spoof actually, of the Rovers have beaten them twice this year.
Spoof of the week, Dan.
It's only one man. It's not Rovers manager, Crawley, Trevor Crawley. He just has to go.
Because he, in fact, believed that he only had to play every other team twice.
I think that was the problem. Like, you know, it's just... Yeah, we'll take a break here, lads. Sorry, if anyone's not watching, Neil is having a fit here of laughter. He's taking his headphones off.
Not watching on the live camera stream. No, we are going on.
There's beads of sweat coming down off his head.
There probably is. No, in all fairness, though, why is he spooked?
Well, because he has to go. He's just, like, as I said earlier, there's four home games. They've scored two goals in four home games. They've been lucky to beat Athlone, ironically. Early in the year, they were lucky to get a 1-1 draw against Limerick at home. They drew 0-0 to Bowes. They've lost 1-0 to Drogheda. They've lost to Cork. They've lost to Dundalk. At their home form, they scored 10 goals at home all year. For Rovers. Like, it's absolutely a disgrace. I've never seen worse football in my life at home for any team. So, no, he has to. Like, Pat Fennell is the man to come in. And it's only a matter of when. And if, but you see, the whole thing is, there's still a cup run there. And sure. If we can, the cup is starting to kind of take its shape now. I don't know, like, they've got Longford in that. Longford will be well up for it. They've got two ex-Rovers players, Pat Sullivan, they're going to be mentioned, who scored the goal, in Belgrade, and our former captain, Stephen Rice. And they're flying in the Division 1. So, I think, that'll be a really tough game for them. And I think maybe they'll give them that game, and then they'll sack him. If he doesn't do it, because there's nothing else. We're through to the League Cup semi-final. And if people are judging them, we won that last year. We actually won, the Santa Cup last year, and we won the EA Sports Cup and the Leinster Senior Cup. But the Leinster Senior Cup is.
How many cups did it?
We won the League Cup and we won the Santa Cups. The Santa Cups were in the Northern Ireland versus Republic of Ireland. Oh, and then okay. And then the EA Sports Cup is like the League Cup.
It's called the EA Sports Cup?
Yeah.
Oh.
And then there's the Leinster Senior Cup. We won that as well, but that one really, it's, you'd be playing your reserves for that. Like, literally, the B team would have been playing most of it.
The EA Sports Cup?
Yeah.
As in, EA is in the game.
That's why they're in FIFA.
That'd be the equivalent of, like, there being, like, a lower level Scottish League Cup called the Konami Cup, wouldn't it? After
it's a Konami. Konami. Konami.
Something
Konami.
They can afford. Like.
So
now, honourable mention so now, for Nicholas Bentner, who won't sign for a club unless they match his wage demands. Which no one
Bentner seems to be getting these mentions every week.
What is his wage demands?
40 a week.
I saw an amazing Photoshop picture with him with the balloon door on the Ballon d'Or.
The balloon door.
I'm on fucking fire, baby. Okay, let's have it the hero of the week. You picked Tom Cleverley. Oh, man, I didn't ever expect to see him be hero of the week in bold. He's written it in bold, lads. He captained Man United to an incredible 3-2 win over Roma in pre-season. Didn't score all the goals.
He didn't, but for him to be captain of Manchester United when he was the most ostracized player last year and probably the guy everyone wanted out more.
There was a petition going around to stop him being in the World Cup squad.
Yes.
Got a lot of traction.
So, yeah, you sent it to me, actually, in April, May.
No.
So, but I think that's the big thing of it is, it's more of a talking point than anything,
yes.
Is for Rooney to be overlooked. And clearly Van Persie is going to get the role, but I would have been thinking Van Persie be number one captain and number two would be Rooney.
Sure.
Which I don't think would be a ridiculous statement to make, considering he's there the longest.
Oh, I think it's very fair.
Oh no, Carrick would be there longest, Rooney.
I think it might be Carrick.
Oh no, Rooney's there longer than Carrick.
I'd say
Rooney. Yeah, but it's, you know, but like, you know what I mean? Like, Rooney would have been definitely a shot.
I'd love to give it to Carrick. Tell me this. Who would you have as Man United captain? John?
Van Persie at the minute, but mostly because they've sold most of senior players, and frankly, I don't think Rooney would be there if anyone.
Van Persie wasn't a bad captain at Arsenal either.
No, he's not.
You know, like, he
except
was pretty good.
Leaving,
well, I think he was. I think you can see what's going on.
And also
at Arsenal
singing,
at the time.
Putting on Jamaican accents for the away.
Yeah,
and stealing people's football boots.
Yeah, like, I don't know, is he a real captain? Is he?
Well, maybe he can lead by example by scoring the goals.
Yeah, no,
I think he's one of those captains, like Cristiano Ronaldo captain. Ronaldo, would he be the best captain? I think, like, agree. You know, like, yeah. he just leads by example by going, oh, look what I did. That's the standard, you know?
A difference between a figurehead and a captain. Mm. And the thing about Rooney is they've appeased him so much with the new contract, highest paid player, doing everything they could not to let him go.
Van Gaal's about that.
Hardly, yeah, Van Gaal's going to come.
Remember, his transfer request in 2010 as well.
Yeah, we've had two transfers. So, I don't think he deserves it. They've done enough to keep him. But it makes sense. Van Gaal coming in.
Now, not unless they get like a wonder player in, like, you know, he could rival Van Persie for it, but
who? Come on. Nobody's going to come in and just be captain.
I think he could in that team. There's no leaders there.
Yeah?
There's not. Well, with Giggs gone, Scholes gone.
Ferdinand
Vidic, Evra.
Fletcher's probably
is Phil Jones and Smalling going to be the end of it?
Jones, Evans, and Smalling are the only guys they have.
Is Evans hurt? No. I haven't heard him.
Like Raphael picked
in some ways, I'm terrified about United next season, but in other ways, I'm very much not.
I think it's going to be really interesting. I don't think there's, like, I think it's really hard to say Arsenal won't have a good season next year. But I think with Man United, you can't call it.
I can see them being top of the league in, like, November, because they've got some very even fixtures. No. And then I can see it kind of collapse.
Yeah.
That's going to be interesting. And they are going to play the 3-5-2, are they?
I always play that in FIFA. Because they've no, like, their wingers are so poor. Like, Valencia probably be right wing, and Shaw.
David Moyes also gave Nani a 5-year deal.
That was fantastic. What are the good things that he do?
He did many great things.
I think we should make a big podcast for him this week.
Yeah, we could do a David Moyes Memorial Podcast Edition.
You know, after this week. Release instead.
This one has not gone to John's liking. What's the crack? Like, is Mata going to play behind Van Persie and Rooney?
I'd imagine that's the plan. Well, it's the only place you can play Mata.
Yeah.
And Rooney and Van Persie are, you know, probably your standout players anyway.
Two guys sitting on the bench.
Yeah, like, yeah, what's that thing that, what's his name? Klopp. Jurgen Klopp.
Yeah.
He said he nearly cries early when he sees Kagawa playing left wing or right wing or
he was
just like, this guy is so good. And said, I would listen to what Klopp said.
He
I think
said something
he's excellent.
Brilliant about the almost transfer. I can't remember what it was.
Oh, he said, what did he say? Sounds like a broom talking shit or something.
I don't think he'll go. The only place he go is Barca.
And
he wouldn't go to Madrid.
Almost.
I don't think he goes to Madrid.
I'm surprised. Like, I don't know why Madrid wouldn't go in for him. He's kind of a polarizing character, but people do rate him a lot higher than others.
Quite injury prone.
Is he?
Well, for a centre back.
He's a bit injury prone.
Any word on the Shaq attack in terms of Liverpool? I heard a £14.5 million bid was placed, but then the Echo said that no bid was placed.
I don't know, to be honest. Like, I heard he was going to Rome at some point.
Shaq attack? Oh, I did hear that. Well, yeah.
So I don't know. I'm assuming he'll be transferred soon. He could end up at Atletico Madrid. Is that one of those?
All right. Well, listen, in closing, guys, and let's keep it, TV14? Yeah, not R-rated or black exploitation.
Literally R-rated for John.
It wasn't that bad.
No, literally.
It was for comic effect.
If we actually do start getting, feedback on a regular basis, I'd like to open up a competition to see if people can guess what you actually said. Probably easier than you think.
It wasn't.
Here, Neil, we have to get the beep
up again.
I know. You know what to do. All right, it's one of those things. I think we should just mute John's microphone in about 1 hour, 10 minutes, kind of now on. Maybe it just have to be air mark.
I'm going to do a little test, because we have this new sound gear in that we're doing for the ITK Soccer Show and for This Ain't Fake, Brother, our sister podcast. And this is the first time we're actually using this gear. So what we're going to do is I'm going to bleep that out. Well, I'm going to give you another opportunity to say a dirty word, right? But what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn his mic down. So, on the off chance that our mics pick it up, it'll get to stay in. I won't bleep it. It's okay? So you ready, John? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay. Let's see what happens.
It's a tiny little...
Is there? Let's see.
It's that lad there.
A little fella, yeah.
Another little lad.
All right. So, and let's look forward to next week's show. What's going to be on next week's show?
Well, I think we're going to do a bit more of a preview of the championship maybe as well, because this has been very Liverpool dominated. We haven't really mentioned Leeds. So we're going to be talking a bit about Leeds next year, next week. And we're going to be recapping more League of Ireland and stuff. And there's going to be a lot more transfers as well. I think a lot of things are going to kind of blow up now next week as well.
Transfer window-wise, I think this has been...
it's been ticking along. It's been ticking along. But I think, you know...
It's a bit nuts, to be honest.
Yeah, so there will be things starting, and you know, we can always start let's say, racking our brains of what kind of 11s will be happening in the Premier League and stuff as well. Okay.
Yeah, I can't wait for that. It's gonna be really exciting. Okay, so thanks very much to Don. That's a mix of the two of you.
Bleep that.
Okay, pause ready. Okay, so thanks very much to John, and thanks very much to Dan, collectively known as Don.
My dad's name. We're getting a t-shirt made.
Oh, please. Yeah, the two of your heads coming out of one body. And yeah, thanks very much to everybody who listened. We're going to be back next week, hopefully on the same day. We're going to try and make Tuesday the day we put up the show. So I've been Neil Marshall on behalf of the ITK Soccer Show. And we'll talk to you all very soon. I guess the intro song this week, because of all the confusion with League of Ireland, is going to be something math related. Is that okay?
If you want to.
That's really hard for Let's Get Physical. But we'll do all right.